We stand to begin our service by singing carol number 15, O Come All Ye Faithful.
Thank you.
mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Well, welcome to our St. Stephen's Day service. And also we'll remember this morning Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who sadly passed away. So welcome this morning. Welcome to our lovely choir who has yet again turned out for us. And welcome to everybody at home. So let us start with our prayer for the last candle that was lit at Mass on Christmas Eve. Holy God, you left the glory of heaven to take upon yourself our fragile humanity. You came to us in love, and yet we denied you room, and you were laid in a manger. May the light of your presence with us shine brightly in our lives, and as we open you into our hearts. Amen.
Christ, the light of the world, has come to dispel the darkness of our hearts. Let us turn to the light and confess our sins. God our Father, you sent your Son full of grace and truth. Forgive our failure to receive him. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Jesus, our Saviour, you were born in poverty and laid in a manger. Forgive our greed and rejection of your ways. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Spirit of love, your servant Mary responded joyfully to your call. Forgive the hardness of our hearts. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive your sins and make you holy to serve him in the world through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Stones against him. Grant that in all our sufferings for the truth, we may learn to love even our enemies and to seek forgiveness for those who desire our hurt, looking up to heaven to him who was crucified for us, Jesus Christ, our mediator and advocate, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Please sit for our readings.
A reading from the second book of Chronicles, chapter 24, beginning at verse 20, which can be found on page 436 in the Old Testament. Then the Spirit of God took possession of Zechariah, son of the priest Jehoiada. He stood above the people and said to them, "Thus says God, why do you transgress the commandments of the Lord so that you cannot prosper? Because you have forsaken the Lord, he has also forsaken you." But they conspired against him, and by command of the king, they stoned him to death in the court of the house of the Lord. King Joash did not remember the kindness that Jehoiada, Zechariah's father, had shown him, but killed his son. As he was dying, he said, "May the Lord see and avenge." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Acts chapter 7, beginning at verse 51, on page 134 of the New Testament. "You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you are forever opposing the Holy Spirit, just as your ancestors used to do. Which of the prophets did your ancestors not persecute? They killed those who foretold the coming of the righteous one, and now you have become his betrayers and murderers. You are the ones that received the law as ordained by angels, and yet you have not kept it." When they heard these things, they became enraged and ground their teeth at Stephen. But filled with the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see the heavens opened, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they covered their ears, and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. They dragged him out of the city and began to stone him, and the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he died. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. You stand for the gospel. We've got a hymn first, a carol first. Number 13, "It Came Upon a Midnight Clear."
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Jesus said to the 12, "Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in the synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Today's Gospel reading, Jesus is already grown up and is warning his disciples that they will be hated, betrayed, flogged and put to death because of him. Not an attractive proposition, to say the least, but he promised that through all their trials the Holy Spirit would support them, and he said that the one who endured to the end would be saved. And that is what we see in the martyrdom of St. Stephen, first person who suffered persecution and death in the name of Jesus. Stephen was one of the first deacons of the newly formed church. The church was growing and the 12 apostles were struggling with the workload of helping to feed the poor. They felt they were neglecting the preaching of the gospel, so they agreed to appoint 7 faithful disciples to serve in practical ways, so that they themselves could spend more time praying and serving the word. We read in Acts that Stephen was exemplary. He did far more than just distribute food. Luke tells us that, full of grace and power, he did great wonders and signs among the people. But, human nature being what it is, some of the established elders in the synagogue didn't like this. They preferred things to stay the way they were, and they weren't looking to change. But we're told that they could not withstand the wisdom of the Spirit with which Stephen spoke. His eloquence and the power of his preaching were such that his words were impossible to ignore. So they decided to get rid of him. They drummed up false accusations of blasphemy and had him arrested and brought before the Sanhedrin. All this reminds us of the way Jesus died, how he was considered to be talking out of turn, telling people they needed to change, and how he made people angry and was rejected, falsely accused and condemned to death. Stephen would have remembered these things, and when he had to face the Sanhedrin, he was filled with the Spirit, as Jesus had promised to anyone who remained faithful. Jesus, when arrested, knowing his divine purpose, remained silent before his accusers. But Stephen, as witness to the gospel, took the opportunity to make a long speech, describing in detail the history of Israel, the patriarchs, the prophets, and the people. He outlined all the times when those who preached repentance and foretold the coming of the Messiah were rejected and killed, up to and including John the Baptist. Now Stephen accused his accusers of being stiff-necked, opposing the Holy Spirit. Their ancestors persecuted the prophets, and they themselves had rejected the Messiah and become betrayers and murderers. Stephen must have known he wouldn't get away with saying these things, but he was so committed to the gospel and the cause of Jesus But as far as he was concerned, he had no choice, and it was now or never. He knew he'd infuriated the council with his words, but he was so filled with the Spirit that when he finished, he looked up to heaven and told them, "Look, I can see Jesus." That was the last straw, and the council lost it completely. They abandoned any legal process and rushed at him in an angry mob, overwhelming him. They dragged him outside and stoned him to death on the spot. And Stephen, as he died, followed the example of Jesus on the cross and prayed, "Lord, receive my spirit and forgive my murderers." So powerful was Stephen's testimony, so radiant was his telling of it, that all they could think of was stopping it before it went any further. But they didn't stop it. Nothing could. Their actions merely underlined its significance. And here we are talking about it 2,000 years later, along with Christians all over the world. In Stephen, there are so many echoes of Jesus' life, ministry and death. He served the poor and needy with commitment and selflessness. He preached the gospel with passion and authenticity. He never deviated from his mission of loving service and the spreading of God's word. And he remained steadfast even in the face of injustice, torture, and death. Stephen died while others stood by and did nothing. We read that the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. Saul would be a terrible persecutor of the early church, and it would be scattered. But the faith and integrity of the church meant that in that dispersal, the gospel would be spread further and wider. It couldn't be stopped. And even Saul, the persecutor, would be convinced and would become Paul, the great leader of the church. Stephen's story helps to remind us why Jesus came into the world. We celebrate at Christmas not as we would for any other baby's birth, not for the joy of the new parents starting a family. The joy Mary and Joseph may have felt was tempered with fear and uncertainty. They were outcasts and they became exiles. They were facing a future beyond their control because of this baby. And in the temple, Simeon would warn Mary that as his mother, a sword would pierce her own soul. No, the celebration of Christmas is all for ourselves, for the whole of humanity, that we are so loved and blessed that Christ's incarnation was for our salvation. As St. John tells us, God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish but may have eternal life. For many people today, Christmas is not a time of undiluted joy. It may be a time of loneliness, worry, or loss. The past 2 years have changed many lives in ways that couldn't have been anticipated. Our challenge is to keep our trust in Jesus and to remain steadfast. And, like Stephen, to proclaim the gospel with all our might, knowing that the Holy Spirit is with us. The shepherds looked up in the darkness of the night and saw the glory of the angels, who said, "Do not be afraid." St. Stephen looked up in his agony and saw the heavens open and God's glory revealed. He knew his faith was justified and he was not afraid. Each Christmas, even in difficult times like these, we too are invited to look up and see God's glory, to know that he is with us and we need not be afraid. Amen.
Shall we stand now to say the creed together? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We like to kneel or sit for our intercession.
God sent his Son into the world to live as a man among us. Let us pray in the confidence of our new life in him. Let us share the humility of the manger, the adoration of the shepherds, and the love of the Holy Family in the light of him who is the light of the world. We give thanks for the joy of this holy season and for all the celebrations we enjoy with our family and friends. We especially remember and pray at this time for all those who are not able to celebrate Christmas as we are able to, for the hungry and homeless in all parts of the world, for countries that are torn apart by war and unrest. We pray for peace throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our royal family, especially Queen Elizabeth. Bless and guide all in authority and direct this and every nation in the ways of justice and of peace. We ask your blessing on all church leaders, especially the ministry team here at St. Leonard's. We pray for your church in every part of the world. Lord, in your mercy. Loving Father, help us to remember the birth of Jesus, that we may share in the song of the angels, the gladness of the shepherds, and the wisdom of the wise men. Close the door of hate, and open the door of love and peace all over the world. Let kindness come with every gift, and good desires with every greeting. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all those who are separated from their loved ones this Christmas and are unable to be with them because of the pandemic. We pray for all those who have lost loved ones due to COVID-19. We pray for all parts of the world where recent disasters have brought devastation to so many people. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all those who are sick, especially those known to us who are in our hearts at this time. We pray for all those named on our weekly news sheet. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. We give thanks for all doctors and nurses and for all caring agencies. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We remember and give thanks for those who have trusted in the Word made flesh and shown God's grace and love in their lives, and whose hope is now fulfilled. We pray for those we have loved but see no longer, and for all who have recently died. At this time we give thanks for the life of Desmond Tutu. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
When the miracle happened, it was not with bright light or fire, but a farm door with a thick smell of sheep and wind tugging at the shutters. There was no sign the world had changed forever, or that God had taken place. Just a child crying softly in a corner, and the door left open for those who came to find. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We stand for peace. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name shall be called the Prince of Peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Shall we offer each other a sign of peace? And now we're going to join together to sing carol number 11, In the Bleak Midwinter.
Thank you.
gluten-free wafers here. If anyone wants them, just let me know when they come up. Now we'll say together the prayer at the bottom of page 10. Word made flesh, life of the world, in your incarnation you embraced our poverty. By your Spirit, may we share in your riches. Amen. The Lord is here.
The Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
All glory and honour be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God. We give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, who for love of our fallen race humbled himself and was born of the Virgin Mary, by the power of your Spirit, and lived as one of us. In the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused his light to shine in our hearts, to give knowledge of your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. In him we see our God made visible, and so are caught up in the love of the God we cannot see. Therefore, with angels of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name, and offer our joyful hymn of praise. Christ our Lord, and as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread and gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory.
Great is the mystery of faith.
Together for that day when your kingdom comes, and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring loves with St. Stephen, St. Leonard, and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Let us join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Christ is the true bread which has come down from heaven.
Lord, give us this bread.
Thank you. Merciful Lord, we thank you for the signs of your mercy, revealed in birth and death. Save us by the coming of your Son, and give us joy in honouring Stephen, first martyr of the new Israel, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, we thank you for cleaning us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work for your praise and glory. Amen. Thank you for being with us this morning. Thank you for being at home with us this morning, and enjoy the rest of your day. And do thank everyone that's put so much into these few days. Hopefully some of you are listening at home, but these wonderful flowers, our wonderful choir, and Sarah playing for us yet again this morning, and all you people that put so much into looking after the congregations, the stewards and everyone. Just beautiful. Thank you. Would you like to stand for the blessing? May the Father, who has loved the Eternal Son from before the foundation of the world, shed that love upon you, his children.
Amen.
May Christ, who by his incarnation gathered into one things earthly and heavenly, fill you with joy and peace. May the Holy Spirit, by whose overshadowing Mary became the God-bearer, give you grace to carry the good news of Christ.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. We're going to sing together now, O Little Town of Bethlehem, number 60.
Silence, God.
is to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.